Just to review what we have considered thus far in relation to Joash being saved from the hands of Athaliah. We looked at the fact that David's throne was jeopardised by this event. The compromise of Jehoshabeath with the house of Ahab had reached its climax now with the murder by Athaliah of her own grandchildren, all but one of David's heirs. So it was a very, very tenuous situation that the house of David found itself in, with a six-month-old baby the only surviving member who could rightfully take over the throne of David. And one evil woman, Athaliah, was outmaneuvered by another faithful woman, Jehoshabeath, whose name, as we saw, meant whose oath is Yahweh. And she, under the hand of God, rescued the throne of David from extinction. Jehoshabeath, with that name, who had obviously dedicated herself to her God, saved this six-month-old Joash from Athaliah with her 95-year-old husband, at least that old, she being in her 20s, hid him in the temple. So we covered that ground in one of our earlier sessions. So we want to have a look now at the accession of Joash to the throne, where that was to lead Judah. And because it is a good start, but a sad ending, this story of Joash, the king of Judah. So this is the period that we're considering. Here on the chart we have got Jehoshabeath, followed by his son Jehoram, then Ahaziah briefly for a year, Athaliah for 6 years, and then Joash for a lengthy period of some 40 years that he reigns. He becomes king at the age of seven. Now, seven-year-olds can't reign. They cannot rule. So clearly he has to be dependent on someone else. And he was, as we will see. Have a look with me at 2 Chronicles chapter 23, if you wouldn't mind. Because here we have that record, verse 1. In the seventh year, Jehoiada strengthened himself and took the captains of the hundreds. So he assembles the captains. He doesn't let the Levites return from their duties in their courses. He retains them. He builds up a considerable body of people, because he knows that there may be some backlash from, or there will be some backlash from Athaliah, and he wants to make sure that she's overwhelmed by the numbers who will support the accession of this seven-year-old boy to the throne. I want you to notice what the record says about Athaliah. Just at the end of chapter 22, verse 12, we read this. And he, Joash, the six-month-old baby, was hid in the house of God with them 6 years, and Athaliah reigned over the land. Now, in my Bible, I have that highlighted because in the following chapter, 2 Chronicles 23, you read this in verse 13. This is where Joash has been made king, and Athaliah hears the noise of the people running and praising the king in verse 12. And we read in verse 13 that she looked, and behold, the king stood at his pillar at the entering in, and the princes and the trumpets by the king, and all the people of the land rejoiced. Yes, she had ruled the land for 6 years. She did not rule the people of the land. Have a look at verse 21 of 2 Chronicles 23. And all the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was quiet after they had slain Athaliah with the sword. Do you get the message? She was there for 6 years, but she didn't have any popular support. Because, of course, of the character of Jehoiada and of the state of the nation at that time, she had no popular support. And so when she was overthrown, there was great rejoicing on every hand. And it was the accession of this king, Joash, who was totally dependent on Jehoiada the priest, that now becomes the centrepiece of the historical account. He couldn't reign at age seven, so he had to depend on his mentor and adopted father, Jehoiada. Athaliah is slain, of course, in the place that she only ever visited once, and that was to object to the accession of Joash. She never went near the temple of Yahweh, had no interest in it at all, and he went there once, and she didn't leave it. Well, she did, but just a little short of where she wanted to go, back to her palace, because she was slain here in this place at the horse gate, as later on we might have a chance to look at in a drawing of Jerusalem as it was in that day. So what about this King Joash? We call him the ungrateful dependent, because that tries to size up his character. He was ungrateful, as we're going to see. He did not return the blessing that had been given to him by being saved from Athaliah and being brought up. He did not return that with gratitude. He killed his own nephew in the temple and showed his utter contempt for what had been done for him in his early life. And so really, when you look at this man, he's a tragic case, a really sad case. He never became his own man, so to speak. Never made up his own mind. He was always dependent on Jehoiada's guidance. And as soon as Jehoiada was gone, he becomes dependent on others. And the princes of Judah, who had been silently waiting for their opportunity, take the opportunity, and Joash joins them in apostasy. His name, therefore, is indeed a misnomer. His name means Yahweh fired, and he wasn't Yahweh fired. He's going to be seen to be this ungrateful dependent, not a man who was generated within himself by the power of the Word of God. And that's what fires you up, isn't it? In your individual attention to the Word of God, that's how you're Yahweh fired. Never happened in the case of King Joash. As I said, he reigns for 40 years. He dies at age 47, which is pretty young. His mother's name was Zibiah, female gazelle. Her name means he was contemporary with Jehu, Jehoahaz, and Jehoash. So it was the dynasty of Jehu that was in the north. And there's, of course, the significant omission in the genealogy of Matthew chapter 1 that we considered in an earlier study. So what were these times like? The times of Joash. Well, Israel in the north was greatly diminished and impoverished by Syrian invasions under Hazael. Now we're going to meet this gentleman, Hazael, a bit later on in the life of Joash, because he brings judgment upon Joash in the most classic case of divine poetic justice in the Bible, in my opinion, and I'll let you be the judge of that later on. So Israel in the north is suffering from Syrian invasions, and Jehu is forced to submit ultimately to the Assyrian king Shalmaneser III, who ruled from 859 to 824. So Shalmaneser comes down. Now, there's evidence of this outside the Bible. Anyone here been to the British Museum in London? Yep, there's a few. A couple have been there. You would have seen the black obelisk of Shalmaneser. This was erected in Nimrud, 825 BC. It was found by Henry Layard in 1846 and ended up in Britain in the British Museum. It's actually a victory monument of Shalmaneser III, King of Assyria. And on that victory monument, we have a picture of the submission of Jehu. So here it is. If you look over on this part of the obelisk, how high do you think that is? Anyone know how high it is? It's about 6 feet, but over 6 feet, 2 metres in Canadian terms. Okay. So it's quite high. I stood beside it. I've got my photo taken as a much younger man standing beside the black obelisk of Shalmaneser. And you see down here Jehu. Now, I think this is interesting because I have no idea really what Israelites looked like in that day. What did they look like? This is the only image I know of any consequence of what they actually look like. So we're going to have a close-up. We're going to take a close-up of Jehu. This is obviously it's an Assyrian who's, you know, prepared this obelisk. But you don't think he would sort of be way out, do you? He's going to get reasonably close to the appearance. And here he is. So it's the earliest known depiction of an ancient Israelite paying tribute around BC 841 to the Assyrian king. So he's bearded. You see that? He's bearded. He has rather long hair, sort of running down the back of his neck. He's wearing some sort of stupid cap that you wear at the end of the year, I think. and he has a rather long. You expect to have a rather long garment wearing. So, but it gives you an impression, doesn't it, of what they probably look like in that time. Now, I mean, that's not really all that important, except maybe at the judgment seat, we're not going to be surprised, are we? When we see people like Jehu and his companions, they'll probably be there dressed up like they were in that day, and we're not going to be surprised. Well, that's how they look. Now, there are two distinct phases to the life of Joash. And as you can see, on the one side here, we have he was Jehoiada dependent. On the other, he's ostensibly independent. Now, that means he appears to be independent, but he's not, as we're going to see. And this is the distinct phases of the life of Joash. And we want to just walk you through that briefly and see what happens in this man's life. So let's just work down the left-hand side. He's rescued, raised, and found wives by Jehoiada. So let's have a look at 2 Chronicles 24, verses 2 and 3. Here he is. Joash did that which was right in the sight of Yahweh all the days of Jehoiada the priest. So he's Jehoiada dependent. And Jehoiada took for him two wives, and he begat sons and daughters. Why would you think Jehoiada would take two wives? I mean, kings had multiple wives in those days, as did others. But why do you think Jehoiada did that? Jehoiada being a very spiritual man. Well, I think there is a reason. Joash is the sole survivor of the house of David. And Jehoiada wants to ensure that there's going to be a succession of the line of David. So he provides two wives, more than likely, so that there can be at least a few sons that could ultimately take over the throne. If Joash was to die prematurely or whatever, there would be someone that could take over the throne. I think that was probably behind his thinking. It says he did right all the days of Jehoiada, and that he was minded to repair the temple. Look at verse 4. And it came to pass after this that Joash was minded, and the two words in the Hebrew, im leb, mean that it was in or near his heart. It was near his heart to repair the house of Yahweh. He declared his disgust for the desecrators of the temple, and we're going to see that in this record of chapter 24. He collected a large sum of money for the temple project. He was supported by the princes and by the people, and these princes are one day going to turn and influence him in a different direction. He successfully completed the temple project, and he dedicated the vessels for the house of God. Okay, got a picture? And he remained faithful all the days of Jehoiada. So if the record ended there, it would be satisfactory, wouldn't it? But it doesn't end there. Sadly, at 130 years of age, Jehoiada dies. You know, people tend to slow down a bit, don't they, when they get into their later years of life. And Jehoiada was slowing down. 130, he couldn't be expected to have the same zip and zeal and strength as a younger man. That's why priests retired. Normally, he couldn't retire. And you see, he was criticised by Joash. We're going to see that. He was criticised by Joash for not being on the top of things in terms of the repairing of the temple. So on the other side of this equation, what do we find when Jehoiada is dead? Well, he succumbs to the advances of the princes. If you have a look at the record of 2 Chronicles 24, in verse 17, it says, "Now after the death of Jehoiada came the princes of Judah and made obeisance to the king. They appealed to his human pride, and the king hearkened to them, and they left the house of God and turned away to apostasy and idolatry." Forsook the house of God and turned to idols. He refused to listen to the rebuke of Yahweh's prophets. He gave command to stone his own cousin, did I say nephew? Cousin, Zechariah, in the court of the temple. He was sorely wounded by the Syrian invaders who came into the land, led by Hazael. And he was assassinated by his own servants, on whom he was entirely dependent. Yes, it's proper, divine, poetic justice that ends this man's life. So let's just step back, shall we? Let's just step back and drill down a little bit to the early years of Joash. And we can learn some lessons from this. There's some important lessons here. So we saw in verse 4 that he was minded, it was in his heart, to repair the house of Yahweh. The word repair means to rebuild, or to renew, as Rotherham translates it. It occurs again in verse 12. In verse 12 you find that same word rendered a little differently, but it's there. And so we have this idea of repairing the house of God, which of course is the role of anyone that's involved in leadership, repairing the house of Yahweh. In verse 5 we read, "He gathered together the priests and the Levites and said to them, 'Go out into the cities of Judah and gather of all Israel money to repair the house of your God from year to year, and see that ye hasten the matter.'" So, you know, young people do tend, they want to get things done, you know, hasten the matter. "Howbeit," it says at the end of verse 5, "the Levites hastened it not." They didn't do it quickly enough for this young man, and he got impatient. Look at verse 6. "And the king called for Jehoiada the chief, and said unto him, 'Why hast thou not required of the Levites to bring in out of Judah and out of Jerusalem the collection according to the commandment of Moses?'" So he criticises Jehoiada for the delay. Got it? Got a picture? Well, we're going to come back in a minute and have a look at verse 7, what he says about Athaliah, that wicked woman. But for the time being, I want to go to the other record. We're not told in Chronicles something that's important. We are told that in the record of 2 Kings chapter 12. So let's come back to 2 Kings, which fills out what happens here in this incident. So we pick this up in verse 4 of 2 Kings chapter 12. "And Jehoash said to the priests, 'All the money of the dedicated things that is brought into the house of Yahweh, even the money of every one that passeth the account, the money that every man is set at, and all the money that cometh into any man's heart to bring it into the house of Yahweh.'" There are three things there, okay? Three distinct things. And we need to analyse what these are. Now this first phrase, "everyone that passeth the account," has the idea, it's abar, crossing over, passing along. It is used in Exodus 30 verse 13 of the half shekel of the sanctuary, which was paid by every Israelite numbered in a census. So if you took a census, you had to pay the half shekel of the sanctuary, and everybody, whether they were rich or poor, paid the same amount. Silver it was, because silver is the symbol of redemption, and everybody, whether they're rich or poor, equally needs redemption. So you only paid a half shekel, regardless of your circumstances. Later on, of course, it was collected annually, and that's referred to in Matthew 17. Remember how the question is raised, should we pay taxes and so on? And Christ says, "Go and cast a line in, take out the fish, and you know, go and pay for yourself and for me." So he's paying the half shekel of the sanctuary. So this first one is obligatory and mandatory. In other words, it's inescapable. You must pay. So that's the first amount that's collected from the obligatory contribution of the half shekel of the sanctuary. But then we read, the money that every man is set at. Now this Hebrew word means to estimate, to value. It is used 9 times in Leviticus 27, verses 2 to 8, of the price to redeem vows. So if you're redeeming a vow, you come along to the priest, he says, well, I think, you know, for the rest of the vow, you need to pay X number of shekels. So the priest nominates what you'll pay. He estimates what you pay. And so that goes into the treasury. So this, what's this? Well, this is assessed or appointed. Okay, something that others assess for you based upon your vow or commitment that you cannot complete or whatever. Then we read this. And all the money that cometh into any man's heart to bring into the house of Yahweh. Now, literally, that could be rendered, come up upon his heart. And of course the word Allah means to ascend, to spring up. So this is about something that's got to do with it arises out of a man's free will. It's not imposed on him. It's not the community's obligation of the half shekel. It's not some imposition because you've had to redeem a vow. This is something that you give willingly and liberally. This is a voluntary contribution. So there's 3 types here. Now that's interesting because you see, when we look at these 3 forms of contribution to the house of God, we can also look at the antithesis of what happened through Athaliah's 6-year reign. Because she desecrated the house of God and her sons desecrated the house of God. So here we've got the summary. 1, the duty required of every man. Submission to obligation. So what's the antithesis to submission to your obligations? Well, lawlessness, isn't it? Not submitting to your obligations. Lawlessness. The second one was the value of dedication over and above duty. The willingness to offer more in building. Now what's the antithesis of that? Well, deliberately breaking something down. So if you're going to contribute the building, the opposite to that is breaking it down. And the third one was offerings freely given from the heart, which is about total dedication to Yahweh. So what's the antithesis of that? Well, dedication to false gods. So instead of dedication to God, Yahweh, you go to false gods. That's the opposite, isn't it, to that? Yeah, well, that was the policy of Athaliah and her sons. They did the antithesis to what Joash says should be done in the collection of the money to repair the house that Athaliah had broken down. So come back to 2 Chronicles 24 and let's see what he says on the back of what we've just learned out of Kings. 2 Chronicles 24, verse 7. This is part of his criticism of Jehoiada and the Levites. He points to this. He says, for the sons of Athaliah, that wicked woman. Yeah, so the older brothers of Ahaziah were taken away by the Philistines and the Arabians, weren't they? Yeah, so there must have been some others. The older brothers, when they were around, this is what they did. There might have been others. But this is what they did under that wicked woman. Now, in the Hebrew, the word for wicked woman, mershahath, means a female wicked doer. And Rotherhand translates it, Athaliah the lawless. Yeah, the antithesis of the first contribution that was made to the repair of the temple. So the policy of Athaliah was to encourage and promote lawlessness among God's servants. She used the immature, her sons, to desecrate and break up the house of God, the ecclesia, and she dedicated the vessels, that is, the vessel stands for the individuals in the house of God, she dedicated the vessels belonging to Yahweh to worldly gods. And that's what he points out here. For the sons of Athaliah, that wicked or lawless woman, had broken up the house of God, and also all the dedicated things of the house of Yahweh they did to bestow upon Balaam. And the word bestow has the idea of offered. They offered them to Balaam. So there's this totally different approach between the young Joash and what happened under the reign of Athaliah. But he has a problem. You know what his problem is? Disrespect. Okay, Jehoiada was old. He was starting to slow down. Yes, the Levites should have been a little bit more on top of the task. They should have been more zealous. Yes, all of that's true. But his criticism of Jehoiada is the first indication of ingratitude. And it is to lead to disaster. So 2 Chronicles 24 verse 6 is a verse worth analysing. When he calls for Jehoiada the chief and begins to criticise. Jehoiada was his father, his adopted father and his mentor. Joash was a son, an adopted son and a student. Jehoiada was nearing 130 years of age. I mean, I'm not even halfway there. And I feel worn out. I'm starting to slow down. Okay? This is the fact of life. You're the young fellows who've got all the energy. We older ones, we older folk, are starting to wear out. Okay? This is why we have schools of the prophets, so you guys can come and do the work in the future. Alright? That's what it's about. So we can retire. No, you don't retire in the truth, do you? Nobody retires in the truth. You should die with your boots on, like Jehoiada did. He died still labouring in the truth. He was worn out, tired. Joash was at his prime. His strength was fading. Joash was young and strong. Jehoiada was looking for rest and release. Joash was looking to make his mark. Right? And what we see here is the first example in this man's life of an ingratitude that was to lead to disaster. Jehoiada had shown by patient endurance his total commitment to the things of God for 100 years. Joash is now showing an unthinking criticism. He could have done it a different way. So we learn a little bit, a lesson from that. But where does all this lead? What happens now that the work does get underway and things start to move? Well, it leads to this conclusion. Come with me to verse 12 of 2 Chronicles 24. And the king in Jehoiada gave it to such as did the work of the service of the house of Yahweh, and hired masons and carpenters to repair his house, and also such as wrought iron and brass to mend the house of Yahweh. So the workmen wrought, and the work was perfected by them, and they set the house of God in his state. You notice that? Now, if I'd been writing that, I would have said they set the house of God in its state. It's a neuter thing, isn't it? It's an inanimate object. It says his state. There's a little hint in that. And I want to show you where that leads us. And it set the house of God in his state and strengthened it. So when it says it was perfected, the two Hebrew words, Allah, Aryukah, mean to ascend to wholeness. Allah means to go up. That's why they call the Israeli airline El Al. Alright? You go up. You fly with El Al. So El Al means to go up. And this idea of perfected is completeness. So it ascends to wholeness. So where does the ecclesia need to go? Because the ecclesia is the house of God, isn't it? Where does it need to go? Well, it needs to ascend to wholeness. Yeah, so you see why it calls the house of God his state? Yeah, there's a purpose in this. They set, it says. They set the house of God in his state. And this phrase, eth amad, in the Hebrew means to stand itself. And of course, the house of God is the phrase Baith Elohim. Literally, the house of mighty ones, which is what the ecclesia ought to be. This is what Paul says, isn't he? In 1 Timothy 3 and verse 15, he says, that thou mightest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the ecclesia of living God, no articles, of living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. And Brother Thomas points out in Eureka that that word ground is the Greek word hedrioma. It means a habitation of mighty ones. And that's what the ecclesia ought to be. If God is walking around in them, this house is a habitation of mighty ones. We understand all that. Because the very next verse, of course, is verse 16. Great is the secret of God-likeness or God-manifestation. We understand that. So in this phrase, in his state, literally it should be rendered to his proportion. And he strengthened it. He made it firm, as that Hebrew word means. So where would you go in the New Testament? Well, you would go to Ephesians chapter 4, wouldn't you? I want you to turn it up with me. All right, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 to 16. So here's Paul's dissertation on where the ecclesia is heading. Verse 11, Ephesians 4. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. What for? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. Yeah, you set the house of God in his state. It's the language, isn't it? Unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important because of what happened to King Joash. You know what happened to King Joash? When Jehoiada died, when they'd achieved this end result, what happened to King Joash was what Paul mentions in verse 14. Ephesians 4, verse 14. Because he goes on to say this, that the whole purpose of building up the house of God is that people don't fall into this trap. That we henceforth be no more children. And Joash was Jehoiada dependent. He was like a child. He never became his own man. He never stood on his own two feet, really. The only time you see any indication of that is when he criticizes Jehoiada himself. But he never really became fully independent. We henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. So who was lying in wait to deceive in the times of Joash? The princes who, to all intents and purposes, ostensibly were supporting the repair of the temple. But they weren't really. They just appeared to be supporting it. They wanted that impression to be given, but they were lying in wait until Jehoiada was gone. And the Rock of Gibraltar eventually died. And the princess said, "You beauty." Now he's out of the way. We got rid of him. Now we can go along and influence this dependent Joash. And by the sleight and cunning of men, that's exactly what they did. And he was impelled into idolatry. And look at the record of 2 Chronicles 24, verse 14. And when they had finished it, they brought the rest of the money before the king and Jehoiada. Notice the phraseology. The king and Jehoiada, whereof were made vessels for the house of Yahweh, even vessels to minister and to offer withal, and spoons and vessels of gold and silver. Paul says there are in a great house there are many vessels of all different kinds, gold and silver and whatever. Yes, it's a reference to people, isn't it? It's a symbol for people. And it says, and they offered burnt offerings in the house of Yahweh continually all the days of Jehoiada. But it comes to an end. Now these offerings that were made, the vessels, speak of individual members of the house of God. And the burnt offerings, which speak of dedication mentally and morally and physically, because the offering was placed on the altar in a certain order. Head first, fat around the vital organs second, then the innards and the legs. mentally, morally, and physically dedicated to God. They were offered continually, a word that is used right throughout the law, for the continual burnt offering and things like that. The stability of the Reformation is attributed to where it rightfully belonged, to Jehoiada. And the record says this of him in verse 15 and 16. But Jehoiada waxed old and was full of days when he died. 130 years old was he when he died. And they buried him in the city of David among the kings because he had done good in Israel. Did I read that correctly? Because he had done good in Israel. He never went to Israel, did he? So what do you reckon that means? You think about that? It means this. That you can work in a place like Jehoiada did for 100 years. He never left it. The temple. And that faithful work will have an impact upon places far away. That's what that means. While you stand firm in this place, it can have an impact on places elsewhere. That's what we're reading. The influence of Jehoiada spread far and wide because he had done good in Israel, both toward God and toward his house. That is a wonderful epitaph, isn't it? If that was put on your tomb, you'd be happy with that. The judgment seat said you've done good towards God and toward his house, which is what we're all about, what we should be all about. But here it goes. 2 Chronicles 24 verse 10 and 17, which we just read, tells us that the princes who were lying in wait to deceive, to turn away to apostasy, they were at the forefront of contributors to the temple fund. They gave the appearance of being in the right place. They rejoiced at the king's commandment, we read. They bowed to enormous influence of Jehoiada, but they harboured secret desires for idolatry. And at the base of that, sadly, like it often is, was sexual perversion. And you read that when you come and you read what they turned to. Verse 18. They left, or as the word means, they relinquished the house of Yahweh, God of their fathers, and served groves. The Hebrew word is Asherah. It actually means to be happy. And of course, this is the goddess of sexual perversions and idols, Atzab, an idolatrous image in an obvious inference there of sexual perversion. That's what they turned away to. And they used flattery when they came to the king. They butted him up to achieve their objectives. And they closed their ears from the appeals that God made. Look at verse 19. Yet he sent prophets to them to bring them again unto him. And they testified against him, but they would not give ear. And they refused to acknowledge divine intervention. Sad story, isn't it? So the house of God was forsaken. Who was in that house? Zechariah. Born of a priest and of a princess. He's like a king priest. Right. He becomes a type of our Lord Jesus Christ. Look what it says about him in verse 20. And the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, the priest, which stood above the people. And he said unto them, Thus saith God, Why transgress ye the commandments of Yahweh, that ye cannot prosper? Or it should read, So that ye cannot prosper. Because ye have forsaken him, he hath forsaken you. Principle of 2 Chronicles 15 verse 2, isn't it, which we considered. So let's analyse this man. He's clearly set forth as a type of Christ. He's clothed with the Spirit of God. He's divinely raised up as a prophet in Judah. He's the high priest elect and son of David. He's conspired against by the rulers of Judah. He pronounced Judah's doom and desolation of the temple, which is what Christ did. He was slain unjustly by the leaders of Jewry, because the record says in verse 21, and they conspired against him and stoned him with stones at the commandment of the king in the court of the house of Yahweh. Thus Joash the king remembered not the kindness So it's ingratitude that motivates it. He committed God committed vengeance into the hands of a man called Hazael. He's sent by Yahweh to bring vengeance upon the house of Joash. So I said to you that Christ refers to him. Now this is a troublesome passage for some. All right, Matthew 23 and Luke 11. We want to have a look at it. So let's go and have a look at Matthew 23. People have discussed and debated this for centuries. So I'm not going to suggest to you that I have the ultimate answer. I'll let you be the judge. Okay, you be the judge. I'm pretty confident. But anyway, you be the judge. So we come to Matthew 23 and verse 35. This is that, of course, the eight woes that Christ delivers against the scribes and the Pharisees. And he concludes that in verse 34-35. We'll read verse 35. That upon you, he says, may come all the righteous blood shed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel unto the blood of Zacharias, the son of Barachias, whom ye slew between the temple and the altar. Verily I say unto you, all these things shall come upon this generation. So it's an apparent reference, isn't it? Just on reading it, it's an apparent reference to the stoning of Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, between the temple and the altar. It's quite specific about that. But is it the case? Is there an answer to the problem of the statement that he's Zacharias, the son of Barachias? Now, Barachias is Barachiah. And if you read the prophecy of Zechariah, Zechariah is the son of Berechiah. Okay? So some say, well, this is the prophet Zechariah at the end of the Old Testament. I don't believe so. I believe it's a reference to Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada. So what are the established facts? The only scriptural record of a Zechariah being slain in the temple is contained in 2 Chronicles 24, verses 20-22. It stands alone. The parallel account in Luke 11, verse 51, omits reference to Barachias. There's no reference to Barachias in Luke 11. Zechariah, the son of Barachias, is the prophet Zechariah, of whom nothing is recorded concerning the way he dies. Not a word. So some suggested solutions from people who have commented on this are: 1. Josephus records that Zechariah, the prophet, was slain in the manner described in Matthew 23:35, and that's according to Jewish tradition. Some commentators suggest Christ's words were a prophecy of the death by stoning in the temple court of a prophet named Zechariah some 36 years after Christ himself. Josephus, Wars, Book 4. Other commentators suggest that Barachias is an interpolation by scribes who thought it impossible that Christ could have met Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, who died some 800 years before his time and was succeeded by many prophets killed by the Jews. Still others suggest that Barachias was a second name for Jehoiada, it being a Jewish practice to have two names. So there's all these sort of suggestions that are made as to how we get around this apparent problem of the name Barachias. Well, here are the reasons why I believe that the Lord is referring to Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada. Firstly, the omission of Barachias in the parallel record of Luke 11 lends at least some weight to the suggestion that it's an interpolation in Matthew 23. The Lord draws heavily upon the account, upon the context of the account of 2 Chronicles 24, and that's important. It's the context he's quoting, not just a few words. And when you compare the accounts of Matthew 23 and Luke 11, you carefully analyse them, you see how much he draws from the context of 2 Chronicles 24. Thirdly, Zechariah, son of Jehoiada, is clearly a type of Christ, as we saw. And compare the allusion, for example, in Matthew 23, verse 37. See, verse 37 says this. Christ says, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. So the record of 2 Chronicles 24 says that Zechariah stood above the people and he calls them back to the house. It's like a mother hen calling back the chickens under her. Fourthly, compare the reference to stoning in Matthew 23:37 with that of 2 Chronicles 24:21. All right, stoning specifically. An almost conclusive evidence, I believe, is found by comparing Luke 11:51 with 2 Chronicles 24, verse 22. Because 2 Chronicles 24, verse 22 says, as he died, he said, Yahweh, look upon it and require it. And in Luke 11:51, Christ says, it shall be required of this generation. He's clearly citing the words of Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada. But here's another piece of evidence. You know, it says in verse 35 that upon you may come all the righteous blood shed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel, the first murdered man, unto the blood of Zacharias. And in the record of Scripture, Old Testament Scripture, he was the last murdered prophet. Because 2 Chronicles is the last book of the Jewish Bible. So you take it from Genesis, Abel, the last book of the Jewish Bible is 2 Chronicles. So the last prophet recorded as being killed was Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada. So it fits. I don't think there's any doubt at all. But then, lastly, the Syrian invasion in which Joash and the princes were destroyed was typical of the judgments of Judah on Judah in AD 70. It shall be required of this generation. Now I want you to come back to 2 Chronicles 24. But you look at the language of verse 22. Because there we read, thus Joash the king remembered not the kindness of Jehoiada, which Jehoiada his father had done to him, but slew his son. Now, as you can see on the screen, Jehoiada's name means Yahweh knoweth. Zechariah, his son's name, means Yahweh remembered. And then we read in this verse, at the end of verse 22, Yahweh look upon it and require it. Now that word look there, or look upon in the Hebrew, is ra'ah. Simply means to see. So guess who God sends? Hazael, whose name means God has seen. Yeah, how fitting that is. Now, we're not told about Hazael on this record, but we know from another record that it is Hazael who comes to bring judgment. Yahweh look upon it, Yahweh see it, and require it. And he sends the man whose name means God has seen. Yes, Yahweh knoweth, and Yahweh hath remembered. And he sends poetic judgment upon this man. It's a parable of the end of Judah's commonwealth, the events of AD 70. Judah, an apostate ecclesia because of its leadership. Many prophets are sent by God, as he sent them here in verse 19 to try and turn them back to his house. Finally, the great prophet, the high priest elect of the house of David, is sent by God and is slain by his own people. A Gentile army invades Judah to execute divine judgment. And the guilty rulers are identified and slain. Let his blood be upon us and upon our children. Guess what happened in AD 70? Those who had survived to that time were identified by the Romans, the ones who'd been involved, identified by the Romans and strung up on crosses. Yeah, so there was divine justice dealt out. Now, I want you to come and have a look at this wonderful case of divine poetic justice here. Joash's beginning was in a bedroom in the palace, true? 2 Chronicles 22 verse 11. 6-month-old baby saved by Athaliah. totally dependent on others. I mean, what can a six-month-old? Can't even crawl, can they? So, totally dependent. He was saved by two women from certain death. Jehoshabeath and his nurse. Two women were involved. He was brought up and protected by his uncle and aunt in the temple. He's the only male survivor of David's house. So there is his beginning, and this is going to be the pattern of his end. Poetic justice. Where does he end up? Look at the record of 2 Chronicles 24, verse 23. And it came to pass at the end of the year that the host of Syria, led by Hazael, came up against him, and they came to Judah and Jerusalem and destroyed all the princes. So they identified the princes who had led him into apostasy. They destroyed all the princes of the people, from among the people. Notice this, they selected them. It wasn't just random judgments. And they sent all the spoil of them unto the king of Damascus. For the army of the Syrians came with a small company of men, and Yahweh delivered a very great host into their hand, because they had forsaken him. So they executed judgment against Joash. And when they departed from him, for they left him in great diseases, that actually is not a great translation, the RSV says, leaving him sorely wounded. So he was wounded. His own servants conspired against him, for the blood of the son, as it should read, singular, not sons, the blood of the son of Jehoiada the priest, and slew him on his bed, and he died, and they buried him, but not in the sepulchres of the kings. Okay? So he began in a bedroom, saved by Jehoshabeath. He ends in a bedroom. He was totally dependent on two women in a bedroom. Now he's totally dependent on others in a bedroom, in the palace. Sorely wounded. And he's killed by the sons of two foreign women. Now there's something very curious here. Have a look with me at verse 26. And these are they that conspired against him: Zabad, the son of Shimeath, an Ammonitess, and Jehozabad, the son of Shimrith, a Moabitess. Now, what would you normally read? You wouldn't read their mother's name, would you? Normally, you would read their father's name. But not here. You read about their mothers. Could you see there are two women there? He began with two women in a bedroom, dependent on them. He's now dependent on his servants, and he's slain by the sons of two foreign women in a bedroom. He had forsaken and forgot his uncle's guidance and the temple, and he's judged because he killed his own cousin in the temple. But it becomes quite exquisite, because you see, these assassins that are listed there for you, Zabad, the son of Shimeath, an Ammonitess, and Jehozabad, the son of Shimrith. It's very, very unusual, that. Extremely unusual. And after all, Moabites and Ammonites were excluded, weren't they, from the house of Yahweh to the 10th generation? Yes. Why? Well, the record of Deuteronomy 23, verses 3 to 6, tells us why the Moabites and the Ammonites were to be excluded from the house of God to 10 generations. You know why? They met them not with bread in the wilderness. They showed no kindness to Israel. And Joash remembered not the kindness. And that word, if you look back at verse 22, that word kindness, you know what that is? It's chesed. C-H-E-S-E-D. It's the divine characteristic of loving kindness. He remembered not the kindness. Moabites and Ammonites did not show kindness to Israel, so God says you're excluded. Beginning to see this? Well, it becomes exquisite poetic justice. Consider the origin of Moab and Ammon. Where did they come from? Now, you know the record of Genesis 19, when Lot has fled from Sodom and he ends up in the cave with his two daughters. It's a horrible story. And out of those events comes the birth of Moab, it means born of my father, right? And Ammon, a people. So here you've got the origins of Moab and Ammon. Where was it? And why was Lot there in that cave? Well, he forsook his uncle and guide, Abraham, went down to the plain of Jordan. He chose another way of life, got mixed up in it. He was a righteous man, we know that. But he got mixed up in another way of life. It destroyed his wife and much of his family. He did not prosper. Just like Joash, turning away from the house of God, it didn't prosper. His house was left desolate. Yes. He ended up in a cave, did Lot, a bedroom, with two women, his daughters. And he was made totally dependent on them by the infusion of wine. And incest produced Moab and Ammon. That is classic divine poetic justice. You don't play around with Yahweh and get away with it. That's the lesson that comes out of that. So Joash is slain in the house of Millo by his own servants. There's the house of Millo down here. So where had Athaliah been slain? The one who was trying to slay him when he was 6 months old. Well, she was slain in the horse gate, less than a stone's throw away. That's where she ended up being killed by Jehoiada and his men. And our Lord Jesus Christ, when he looks back on these events, picks up the language in Matthew 23 and Luke 11, sees himself in Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada. And he speaks these words, the words that would have come from the mouth of Zechariah himself, appealing to his people to return to the house. But this is what they did. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets, and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. And they conspired against him and stoned him with stones at the commandment of the king in the court of the house of Yahweh. So what do you reckon might have happened in the heart of Zechariah's mother, Jehoshabeath? A sword would have pierced her heart like the sword that pierced the heart of Mary. Never forget the unspoken characters that are behind the scenes. Mothers who lose a son in those circumstances desperately, desperately saddened by that, and their heart is stricken through. In our next study, God willing, a little while later this evening, we're studying number 7 for the day, come on. In our next study, we're going to have a look at the prophecy of latter-day Israel, and we're going to see in the life of Uzziah, king of Judah, what Israel today looks like and what they'll be like at the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's all there in the life of Uzziah. But that's the next time around.
BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is a worldwide collaboration by Christadelphians to help promote the understanding of God's Word to those who are seeking the truth about the human condition and God's plan and purpose with this earth and with mankind upon it. Bible Truth and Prophecy is part of a wider set of online resources provided by Christadelphianvideo.org. For establishing just how far removed the true Christian teaching of the first century apostles is from that taught by mainstream Christendom today. BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is very much a standalone website, but benefits from our vast network of sites and resources and social media. Here are just a few of the things that BibleTruthAndProphecy.com offers. We have a good number of written articles supplied to us from brothers from all over the globe. These deal with first principle issues, creation versus evolution, the inspiration of the Bible, and so much more. We have a whole section of video study series. These are studies that have been posted onto our YouTube channel, but because of the difficulty of the search feature within YouTube, we have chosen to host on Bible Truth and Prophecy. So now, every video you search for within the site, you can be guaranteed that it will be of a Christadelphian nature. We also have a preaching video section, where any ecclesia is invited to download and use or embed these videos within their own ecclesial websites. We also have an exhortation service, where we produce two or three exhortations per week, which we then circulate to brethren and sisters in isolation. We also have an ever-growing list of approved Christadelphian sites. We also have a page of live news feeds, so you can keep up to date with all the breaking news as it happens. We also have a section for the daily readings. Each day at around midnight, we publish all three of the daily readings. And then later on in the day, we publish Thought for the Days, often based on all three portions of the daily readings. Within each daily reading post, there is also a link to enable you to have the Bible chapter read to you directly. We also feature Bible in the News videos, videos which we have produced from the Bible in the News website. We also feature Brother Don Pierce's milestone snippets, which come out approximately three times a week. We also feature Andy Walton's weekly World Watch and other commentaries and analysis from other brethren on world news events. You can also subscribe to the blog and be notified of posts as they happen in real time, and also subscribe to the weekly newsletter, which is provided by christadelphianvideo.org. Every page and post on the site has the facility to be able to leave a comment or make an observation, so please take advantage of this and let us know what you think of the site.